So in 1994, a story born out of tragedy was brought to the big screen as a film mired in its own tragedy as a specter of its slain lead actor hovered over it and became a cult sensation. This is the final performance of Brandon Lee in Alex Proyas's The Crow. On the eve of their wedding, young couple Eric Draven and Shelley Webster are brutally attacked in their apartment by a savage gang. Eric is outright murdered, and Shelley later dies in the hospital following a horrifying rape. 1 year later, on the infamous Devil's Night in Detroit, Eric is resurrected from the grave by the supernatural power of the Crow, intent on avenging their deaths. The gang, headed up by the Wild T-Bird and answering to crime kingpin Top Dollar, continue to ravage the city with drugs, robbery, and violent acts. Meanwhile, Eric seeks out each guilty party one by one, leaving a wake of violent retribution through the city. Yet his haunting presence lures the attention of the good-hearted Officer Albrecht, and Eric and Shelley's lonely young friend Sarah, whom he tries to help out at every turn. Yet he knows that his path of vengeance all the way up to Top Dollar himself is the only true way he will ever find peace for himself and Shelley in the afterlife. So released on Friday, May the 13th, 1994, The Crow was met with immediate acclaim and success, grossing $50 million domestically and an estimated $44 million earned in international markets of an ultimate budget of $23 million. And the genesis of The Crow comes from a very tragic point in time in James O'Barr's life, a man who grew up as an orphan in the foster care system, and ultimately in his teenage years, his girlfriend perished at the hands of a drunk driver, which drove him into a deep, dark depression and sense of grief and everything, and tried to use this artistic outlet as a way to probably cope and try to be cathartic with what he was going through and what he was feeling and everything, and developing the story of The Crow, of this man, him and his girlfriend go on and have this random act of violence take both of their lives, and the man comes back in supernatural means to exact revenge on those who killed them. Something that never entirely really kind of gave O'Barr what he was thinking that this process would give him. But ultimately, after many years of after going into the military and trying to work on this comic book and all this type of stuff in 1989, Caliber Comics ended up picking up his story of The Crow, publishing it, and becoming an underground cult success of some sort, building up a little bit of steam over the next couple of years, to where producers Edward R. Pressman and Jeff Most ended up optioning this to be produced into a feature film. And there's some very interesting, unfortunate type of circumstances that go into the making of The Crow that everyone is very much well aware of, because during production on this film, the star of this film, son of the Kung Fu legend Bruce Lee, Brandon Lee, was ultimately killed during production with only 8 days of filming left to go because of a firearms malfunction where earlier in the shoot they were using a revolver having close-ups on it, then they used these sort of something that looked like a real bullet, so instead of using professional dummy rounds, they ended up manufacturing some dummy rounds with just bullets with the gunpowder poured out, but they still had the primer in the butt of the bullet, so when the thing ended up firing, it lodged the bullet partway into the barrel of the gun. And so later on in the film, when they actually need to use blanks in to simulate the visual of a gun firing with the smoke and everything, they still had the dummy round in the barrel of the gun when they loaded the blank, which doesn't have a bullet in it, but still has the gunpowder and the primer in it to hit an explosion outwards through the barrel. And when the actor in the scene ended up firing the gun, it dislodged that in the barrel of the gun, went into Brandon Lee's abdomen, was rushed to the hospital, but after several hours of surgery, he was pronounced dead on March 31st, 1993, in a terrible, tragic event that halted production for 6 weeks as people wondered what to do with the film. Original distributors of Paramount Pictures didn't want to go ahead and continue being associated with the film after some various things with the amount of violence that was in the film and the tragedy involved with it. But it was ultimately Brandon Lee's fiancée of Eliza who ended up giving her blessing to director Alex Proyas to go ahead and finish this film in tribute and memory to Brandon Lee, who poured so much of himself into this performance and believed so strongly in the material that this film had to offer. But after all this occurred, Instep, Miramax, and Dimension Films poured an additional $8 million into the already $15 million budget, giving an overall final budget of $23 million, and able to complete the film, fill in the gaps with some cutting-edge digital technology to kind of finish off a couple of scenes where they didn't have the ability to have Brandon Lee there and just kind of composite him into different shots and try to get the most out of what they had already filmed with Brandon Lee using stunt doubles and various other people, including Chad Stahelski, who as many people would know as the credited director of John Wick and John Wick Chapter 2, being the stunt double for Brandon Lee in this film. But fact of the matter is, it was nice seeing that another studio decided to believe in this film as well and give them the extra money they needed to get the whole thing finished as best they could possible. And this whole film really comes together just on such a great level because director Alex Proyas at this point in time, he'd done a couple of short films and a few other feature films here or there, were very small budget type of things. But this was the first thing that he really had to really kind of make a name for himself. And he saw so much potential with the story and the source material here. They wanted to create a very visually striking and just sort of cutting edge, almost alternative rock type of film that just shows through in every single element that he ends up using for this film, because the visual style of this film is actually absolutely fantastic. I mean, that is one of the things that everyone has always praised this film for. Some seem to kind of give it some sort of reference back to Blade Runner, but aside from some film noir elements and the fact that it's raining almost all the time, I don't see too much of a Blade Runner connection for me personally, because the film is such a starkly different visual film in a certain way, where something like Blade Runner is very vibrant and very alive with many different colors and neons, all this type of stuff. Alex Proyas was going for a very narrow color palette. He almost wanted to film the whole thing in black and white with only the flashback scenes in color, but executives and producers and whatnot were not very comfortable with that idea, so he went ahead and made the film very stark in a certain way with only black, white, and red as the colors you see on screen almost exclusively. And just, I just love looking at this film because it has the, just, you've never seen a film that is that stark, that just gets the black so absolutely perfect and has such a almost gray palette without any kind of flaw anywhere. But when you do get those reds popping in there and the fire and the blood and whatnot, and all these washes of red in the flashback sequences, it just shows off such an amazing artistic eye from Alex Proyas, who did implement sort of a cutting edge early 90s MTV style with things, with some of the flash frames and cuts he has here and there to just give the film such an energy and an edge to it. He just comes in with the film with so much visionary potential that he absolutely fantastically realizes so exquisitely well. I just love how much this film just looks so amazing. I mean, you had something that started off with like Batman, Tim Burton's Batman, that had this sort of style, but it didn't have all that energy. It didn't have that kind of stylized feel to it. It had the dark gothic stuff, but Alex Proyas had so much more to offer as a visualist, as a stylist in this film, to give us so much that just hit on the pulse of what the pop culture was at the time, the alternative rock scene and all that type of stuff, hitting at that point in time, reflected so much in the soundtrack of this film, implementing bands like Rollins Band and The Cure and Stone Temple Pilots and Pantera. All these bands just fueled further into what Proyas was intending from the film from the very start, to have that rock and roll vibe to it and just have that style soak into so many things, just have that being the driving energy throughout the entire film. This film is so much driven stylistically by what Alex Broye has brought to the screen, brought to the mix of this entire idea here. And I think they just chose the absolute right director to hit on that pulse and give you something so cutting edge at the time that it feels almost like an encapsulation of a moment in pop culture. You hit that spark of a moment in time there with everything that Broye has brought to this film that almost makes it a timeless adventure that doesn't date it in any particular type of way. You can see this film and feel that time, but also feel so much more into the depth and fiber of this film that just comes out so magnificently well with so much of the talent that is involved with this film. And indeed, the true shining star of this film is Brandon Lee himself, who puts in such a genuine performance with so much beautiful layers and depth and wonderful charismatic charm that you get with this character. There's so much of the emotion that he puts forth on screen just feels absolutely authentic, down to the very soul of him. You can see how much of himself he poured into the depth of this character, the depth of this film, how much he absolutely cared about every nuance he was bringing to the screen, every sense of physicality he had, chiseling his body to mirror that of the character in the comics, and just bringing out the words and the soul and the depth of this character. It's such a touching performance, what he does in so many different scenes. Especially, I love the scene that he has with Ernie Hudson in Albrecht's apartment. And there's just these beautiful little moments where you just see that he's just heartbreaking beats in that scene, that he just has these expressions on his face and these little moments that just absolutely tug at your heart and just absolutely pour himself out on screen, unbridled, very raw. But he has so many other fantastic elements of his performance here, because when he starts embracing that after he gets resurrected and he's just this sort of instinctual beast or whatnot, being guided by the crow into the apartment, putting on the makeup, and eventually just kind of getting focused into the zone of what he's there to do, you see this sort of strange exuberance come out of him, this playful charisma that he ends up putting on throughout the rest of the film, that he just, whenever he's confronting these people from the gang or whatnot, he has such an alluring, riveting charisma in the film that he just, it just leaps off the screen at you, because he's just playing these scenes with so much zeal to himself. You just see the life pouring out of this character, who's a man resurrected from the grave, but you just see the life, the energy, the exuberance that he has. He's a little off balance in a certain way, that this entire experience just seems so absolutely perplexing to him in a certain way. It kind of drives him a little bit cuckoo in certain sections of the film, where he just has this weird, playful quality to him that just plays these moments off just with so much nuance, so much great care, and so much just lightheartedness in a certain way. It's just an interesting thing mixed in with the conviction that the character has, these moments where he's just absolutely focused and intense in certain sequences and certain interactions with these characters, like he is in the alley with Tintin, or when he confronts Gideon. I love the moment where he grabs the wedding rings and starts telling him each one of these is a life you helped destroy. These moments where it's just like he's so focused into the absolute emotion and the conviction, the anger of this character. It's just such a great package altogether, this mix of the sorrow and the heartfelt qualities, and then the more dire type of things that he has going on himself, just racked with pain at certain points in time, where he gets all these terrible flashbacks mixed in with the action film revenge type of stuff. All these things come together in such a core package that Brandon Lee puts on the screen as an absolute wicked star in this film, that he put on a performance of a lifetime in this film, that had he lived, this would have been a launching point for such a deep and spectacular career for him. By no doubt, beyond just an action film, he shows so much depth and range and so much genuine care for what he does that everything feels so much like an actual three-dimensional character living on screen with you. There's just so much heart in what he portrays here on screen, and takes every element, all these different parts of the character, throughout the different spectrums, all these elements come together in such a natural package of energy, charisma, and just heartbreaking qualities. Even putting the tragedy aside, I can see the quality of acting he put into this and just everything else he just poured out from his soul to put it out on screen, not leaving anything behind. I think it's just a fantastic performance, one of the most beautiful performances I've ever seen on screen. If you didn't have someone with that much talent ahead of this film, it might not have gained that much of a loyal cult following throughout all these years. But Brandon Lee, he had so much talent to offer. He really brought it and made this film so much of a fantastic film. Let's move on to someone like Ernie Hudson, who's always a fantastically reliable actor here, and as Officer Albrecht, who is kind of a merging of two different characters from the source material, just kind of simplifying and streamlining things a little bit there in the whole makeup of the film. He just has that fantastic, down-to-earth sense of humanity, and just a guy who's completely approachable, and the warmth that he brings to a character. He just lights up the screen whenever you see him, because he just has that wonderful quality of just being very approachable. He's a guy who has a lot of light within him, who's gotten through some bad times and whatnot, being demoted and going through a divorce and everything, but he's still got a good sense of doing the right thing at the right time, and he's that guy who comes in at the right moments in time to really help people out and doing what he feels is right in the moment, even if he is getting suspended and all this type of stuff through the police force. He's still a guy who does what his heart feels he should do. And Ernie Hudson really does a solid portrayal in this film as a character you can really connect with. And even Rochelle Davis as Sarah holds a nice bit of weight in this film as also the person who's going to give us the narration and a little bit of the mythology backstory into what's going on in the film. But she holds her own so very well in this film, holding up some nice heart, a little bit of conviction as well. It's just like this character who is this sort of wayward type of person who lost two of her closest friends a year ago, but can still kind of hold her own, still stand up. She's still got a strength to her in a certain way. So it's like nice seeing this character who does have that heartfelt thread throughout the entire film and is able to be the one to kind of carry on the memory of Eric and Shelley and everything. And just like she does a nice piece of work in this film. I think it's very, very admirable for a young actor for this film and everything. But moving on to a bit of the nastier characters in this film, you've got David Patrick Kelly as the character of T-Bird here, who was very much looking to read for the character of Top Dollar here, but did take some persuasion to sign on as T-Bird. But it's such a great thing that Alex Proyas and Brandon Lee were such big fans of the Warriors, and very pleased to have David Patrick Kelly involved with the film here. And he puts on a great portrayal here as T-Bird, because he brings that charismatic, sleazy quality that you know from many of his roles. He gets a little bit typecast in that type of thing early on or whatnot, but he portrays that so very well in this film. Just like he relishes the moments that he gets to play on screen here, and just like he stands out so very strongly and vibrantly amongst the cast. And just like David Patrick Kelly as an actor in general, but he has some good scenes in this film, especially like his last scene in the film. I just love that point where after Eric has done this whole car chase sequence and he's ended up at the pier or whatnot, and you just get that moment where T-Bird recognizes Eric as the man that they killed a year ago, and just like this reaction that he has, it has emotion to it, it has this disbelief, it has this bewilderment to it, and just like this moment, I love this moment in the film. It's like that point in time where that guy realizes that the man they killed is here as a sort of spectral type of figure to take them out. It's just a great little moment that he plays, and everything he does in the film is just top-notch type of stuff. Absolutely love it. And you get such a great mix of fantastic cast. You got Tony Todd, you've got John Polito, Michael Massey, a lot of great actors in this whole thing, just adding to a eclectic and highly talented mix of people. Kind of headed up a little bit here by Michael Wincott as Top Dollar, who's a little bit of a change from the source material, because in the source material, the leader of the gang was T-Bird, and Top Dollar was just a sort of low-level drug dealer, but they kind of changed things up to have sort of a big crime kingpin in this film, and it casts a really good actor of it, because Michael Wincott, I really love what he tends to do with a lot of roles, And it's a bit of an interesting slant they kind of take with his character. Don't take Top Dollar and make him a very detestable type of villain. And then make him a very entertaining type of villain, which Michael Wincott is absolutely, completely adept to totally do in this film. But there might be a few moments where that feels like it kind of shifts the tone a little bit off-center in certain points in time where he's being very big and verbose. And feels like in certain points maybe it's just from his gravelly voice, which is beautiful, but kind of feels like maybe he's channeling a little bit of Jack Nicholson Joker in certain points in time, being very big, over-the-top, verbose type of stuff. But still entertaining. It still very, very much gets you into the moment of the film. You're still hooked into this character to a certain degree or whatnot. And he's got this weird relationship with his sister in the film, which she's portrayed by Asian actor Bai Ling. So it's like, I don't know, they're half brother and sister. It's not really explained. It's a little bit on the edge of ambiguous type of oddness or whatnot. But it's like, as these occultish type of things, all this type of weird mystery around this character or whatnot, that he has a certain aura to him, but he's also has such a blunt, matter-of-fact type of thing in certain moments where it's like, he'll be theatrical one moment, but then kind of like saying, oh, fuck it, just blow the guy away. So it's like a nice thing where they don't just go for something straight and predictable. It kind of jumps back and forth a little bit on different kind of feet, so it keeps the character kind of on his toes or whatnot, to not just be stereotypical. It'll be a little bit of verbose, but then he kind of drop the shit and just kind of go for it. So it's like it creates a nice slight unpredictability with the character, where he's going to be a little theatrical, but he's also going to be very kind of like down and dirty and gritty and do some stuff here. So it's like Michael Wincott does do a fantastic performance here. I just think at certain points of time, some of it might seem like it's a little out of tone with the more serious sort of down-to-earth type of stuff. He's a little bit punching it up in certain places, but it's not the fact that he doesn't do a good job with it. I just think it might have been toned down a little bit if you're going to keep a consistency of tone, but it's nice to have an entertaining villain there amongst all these sleazy, detestable ones. So it's like a nice change up of the mix, a little contrast there. And you got Tony Todd there. He's a little bit more of a sophisticated sort of right-hand man type of guy. It's a nice thing. And this was also written by two really good people here, two novelists and screenwriters, with David J. Scow and John Shirley. So this was in very good, solid hands. They put together some fantastic characters, write some wonderful, sharp dialogue in this whole thing that just keeps you invested in the whole film. And it gives you lively, colorful characters you can just connect with and give you, again, that depth of emotion in certain places. So it's like it has all the vibrance and all the substance where it needs to have substance, and gives you the color of the characters where you really need to have that kind of push and pull with the entire story and the drama and the action, all this entertaining qualities. So it's like all the things come together with the screenwriting, the casting, the dialogue, the different styles of characters and whatnot. I think they did a nice, hell of a fantastic job putting together a wonderful cast in this whole thing. And despite having a $23 million budget, which, like I said, was originally $15 million, until Miramax ended up putting in an extra $8 million to finish the film, using cutting-edge digital effects to take Brandon Lee's face, put on a stunt double, or to composite him digitally from one scene into a different one to get all these scenes put together for the final version of the film, they really didn't have enough money to take use of digital effects for a large majority of the effects in the film, so they used a lot of composites optically and using miniatures as well. A lot, pretty much all the flyovers throughout the entire film of the city are all miniatures done, and even early on when you're seeing all the flames going off in the city, they actually figured out a way to actually project flames onto the miniatures as the camera was panning through the entire city. It's a bit of a complicated type of process, but it was a much more effective type of way, much more high quality way to go, instead of going on very, very dead cheap type of visual effects they could have gotten through CGI at the time, which would have been very expensive and end up looking very cheap with a little budget. They end up going the right route with all these effects, even if they do have a very unusual type of effect in certain sequences where they don't look quite realistic enough, but it adds to sort of the stylistic type of quality to the film in a certain way, a very odd type of thing that's very unique to the film in a certain way. When they actually had to do the car chase sequence, they're filming on a back lot with not a lot of road to work with. Pretty much the entire car chase sequence where the cops are chasing T-Bird is all miniature work. and it's almost impossible to see, aside from a little bit of shots here and there, you can almost not tell at all that these are miniatures being shot. It's an amazing feat that they really nailed it with a lot of the effects in the film, with only a few little things looking a little bit off, a little bit obvious in certain places, they still executed effects very nicely in this film. And basically, probably only the effects of Eric healing or whatnot from certain wounds might have been done digitally. Alex Proyas, in retrospect, is not entirely certain if they did that optically or digitally. But regardless of that, I think they did a nice job with the budget that they had to achieve the effects that they could achieve and needed to achieve to realize this dark, bleak Detroit that Alex Proyas had kind of come up with for the visuals of this film to inhabit the action and story of this movie. Is a nice piece of work from the effects team of DreamQuest. They really achieve this type of quality and not a lot of money, but they really did it and really pulled through where they had to and used those special digital effects to get those shots that they needed to complete the film after Brandon's untimely death in this film. They did a nice job to put everything together as best they possibly could. And Alex Proyas' visual style was so much realized by cinematographer Darius Wolski, who ended up going on shooting films like Crimson Tide, Dark City, the first four Pirates of the Caribbean films, and many recent Ridley Scott films. This guy is a solid cinematographer, and having this being one of his early feature films that he ended up shooting really put a stamp on his career because, like I said early on, Proyas' visual style is so absolutely striking in this film, and Darius Wolski captures amazing visuals in this film, again using gothic and film noir type of sensibilities to give you stark images, but also very warm, haunting, and very heartfelt type of moments in the film that just envelop you into this entire bleak world where there's so much, again, that underlying heartfelt nature to the story and everything. The cinematography of the film just has so many beautiful moments that highlight the love, the life emanating from the film, the sorrow that's in the fiber of so much of this stuff that's going on. It just strikes so much of a great chord throughout the entire course of the film. And even when you get into the action sequences where it's just sharp, kinetic type of stuff with such a stylized edge to them, you get some great things in the alleyway, again with Tintin. But also, when you get that big shootout and everything where you got the flashing lights from the gunfire and the strobes, all this type of stuff happening all over the place, it's just, they're trying to go for a little, the John Woo type of kinetic Hong Kong action. Didn't quite make it there, but you can kind of see that what they're inching towards. They're kind of taking a little bit of that inspiration and trying to apply it into this thing with the visuals, the cinematography, everything is lit and angled and shot and composed and moved through different scenes. It just hits off so very well. The cinematography is so absolutely beautifully done in this film, supported by a wonderful score. I think Graham Revell's music for this film, which Alex Proyas was kind of thinking the musical score was going to be a little bit incidental next to the rock energy of the film and everything, but this is what I remember so much from the film. So much of what Graham Revell does with the heartfelt qualities of the score and the darker sort of gothic type of stuff. It does kind of build a little bit on maybe some of that Danny Elfman type of stuff you might think, but he just puts on so much of that depth into the music, the little bit of the theme that you have flowing through this film, where you just have that swell of emotion coming up, the sorrow and the heartfelt qualities of it. That is what I remember from this film so wonderfully much, with the music, just those light beats that just touch your heart so much and just chokes me up every time I hear that theme come in. It just hits me so strongly, and it just does so much good stuff with getting some darker moments and darker beats, the action type of stuff, just having a little bit of energy and a little bit of a darker edge to certain places where it's giving that gothic type of edge to everything. I just think what he does with the score here is a fantastic piece of work. And whenever I think of Graham Revell, this is the standard I hold his work up to. If it doesn't reach this kind of standard, doesn't have this type of nuance and quality to it, and heartfelt sort of passion put into it, I don't think he's done enough good work. If that isn't reached, he's done some fantastic scores since then. I love what he's done with the Riddick franchise, Pitch Black and onwards, but he's done some fantastic work with The Crow here and came back for Lee's Crow, City of Angels, kind of reworked some of his qualities of the themes and musical score and whatnot, still give it a similar feel, but he does such a fantastic piece of work, making this film sound absolutely wonderfully gorgeous to me. But just with this film in general, you got so many different things going on with stylized visuals and dark gothic fantasy and a rape revenge action film with supernatural elements into it. But it's so much the emotion that makes this film so special, makes it a beloved film that people return to time and time again, that if it was just a kind of shadow action film of sorts, it would still dazzle and amaze people, but it wouldn't have the soul that it has, the heart that is so very much pulsating throughout this entire film, channeled so much with Brandon Lee's beautiful performance, Grammerville's gorgeous score in this whole thing, and just Alex Proyas's attention to detail and the care that he put into this film. Everyone had such a sense of heart and passion. I just think the soul of this film is a beautiful thing to behold. It's something I wouldn't say just for anything. I just feel like this film does have a soul to it. It feels like it's alive so much in so many different parts of it. It just feels like it has a life of its own that just comes out and it does affect me. I do get teary-eyed. I do get choked up watching the film, not just because of the tragic elements that surround it, because there was that much heart put into the depth of this film, into every fiber, every shot, every little thing. Everyone wanted to make this film as best it possibly could, including Brandon Lee, the heart that he put into this, and so much of what everyone else really wanted this film to become. It very much became that, despite the tragic passing of Brandon Lee and all these things that really didn't come together quite as much. There's a lot of deleted material from the film that did have to be cut out. Some stuff like the Skull Cowboy, who was kind of this expositional character in the source material, The Crow and everything, that Alex Proyas decided the character really didn't work on screen. They didn't have the best prosthetics, the best sort of design for the character to really make him very convincing on screen, portrayed by cult actor Michael Berryman. They decided to scrap that prior to Brandon Lee's death, but obviously having him pass away made it much more easier to just cut it, because they could not have shot any further scenes between the two characters. And so it just comes down to the fact that despite having a few little things that were cut out throughout the entire film, that if you really know that they're there, you can kind of pinpoint things to kind of pull yourself on, especially, you know, about all the stunt doubles and the body doubles that are used, or you can kind of have that swirling around in your mind. Seeing this film as purely as you can, it comes off as a fantastic film that is visionary, loaded with so much soul and heart and depth. This is a fantastic film that I think absolutely stands up with such a great sense of quality to it. The Crow is a special film that every time I watch it, it just has such a great effect on me. And I hope you guys will use this video as a little bit of a discussion forum to kind of get your feelings out about the film, what you feel about it, what your history is with this film, because I knew being in high school at the time this film came out, people were wearing Crow shirts, people were dressing up as Eric Draven for Halloween and everything. It was very much, I was the right age for people to have been very much into the whole thing. I wasn't allowed to see R-rated films for a couple more years, so kind of didn't get into it until later on, but the fact of the matter is, I knew this thing was a craze at the time. I knew there were people who were just absolutely into this film, like living crazy, and just like hell, this is a fantastic film that is worthy of that type of cult status. And just, I can go on and on and on. The fact of the matter is, guys, it's a fantastic film. Get your comments below. Your thumbs up on the video is always wildly appreciated. And guys, thanks for being around, hitting subscribe buttons, and all the fantastic stuff. I enjoy your company. Hope you enjoy mine. So guys, thanks for watching. Take care. Bye-bye.